Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah hamdan katsiran tayyiban mubarakan fihi mubarakan alayhi kama yuhibbu rabbuna wa yirda. Jalla jalaluhu wa amma nawaluhu. Nahmaduhu wa nashkuruhu wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa huwa wahdahu la sharika lah. Wa nashhadu anna sayyidana wa maulana Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa baraka wa sallama tasliman katsiran katsira. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وقال الملك إني أرى سبع بقرات سمان يأكلهن سبع عجاف وسبع سنبلات خضر وأخر يابسات يا أيها الملأ أفتوني في رؤياي إن كنتم للرؤيا تعبرون قالوا أضغاث أحلام وما نحن بتأويل الأحلام بعالمين صدق الله العظيم. Respected brothers, elders, young friends, and honorable listeners. Before we commence, today the world, and especially the UK, lost a very close friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People may have heard that Mufti Muslihuddin Qasmi, Sayyid Qasmi, rahimahullah ta'ala, may Allah ta'ala envelope him in his mercy, passed away today in Dewsbury. And you know, it was very sad news for every single person, for the UK, for people around the world. He was a teacher of teachers, Sheikh al-Hadith in Dewsbury, who had taught the Sahih al-Bukhari for numerous years, maybe over 20 years. And you know, it's just sad to see the state where in the last year we've lost so many influential ulama around the world. I'm sure there was a list going around sometime that there was over 200 ulama that have passed away. Well-known ulama. And this is one of the signs of Qiyamah as well. Nabi Sallam says that Allah Ta'ala won't take away ilm by snatching it away from the hearts, but Allah Ta'ala will take away intizan biqabdil ulama, by taking away the ulama. We pray to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, He safeguard us. So this was, you know, he was a very humble individual, a very close friend, a pious servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these humble individuals, like someone said that, كَمْ مِن مَجْهُورٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَشْهُورٍ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَكَمْ مِن مَشْهُورٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَجْهُورٍ فِي السَّمَاءِ. There are some individuals who are famous on the earth, but they are unknown in the heavens. And there are some individuals who are unknown. Many people won't have even heard of his name. They are unknown on the earth, but they are famous in the heavens. We need to become from those, from the latter, where we are unknown on the earth, but we are known in the heavens. And this is what counts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevate his ranks in Jannatul Firdaus. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all his khidmat and all his efforts. And may Allah ta'ala grant sabr to all of his muta'alliqeen and those who he has left behind. And the least we can do is take a moment to recite three times Surah Ikhlas and send it as Isal al-Thawab from Mufti Muslihuddin Sahib. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So we are continuing with our tafsir and the exegesis of this amazing chapter of the Quran, Surah Yusuf. And we concluded the last session where Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam, he had impressed upon the inmates the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, monotheism and tawheed. And after concluding this discussion, he went on to interpret the dreams of the two inmates. And in a very amazing way, he says to them, not directly that this is going to happen to you. He says, no, amma ahadukuma fayasqi rabbahu khamra. One of you shall pour wine for his Lord, for his master, and the other one shall be crucified. قُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ الَّذِي فِيهِ تَسْتَفْتِيَانِ. The matter in regards to which you inquired has now been decreed. So this is what happened, that one was acquitted of any charge, and he was reinstated as the wine bearer of the king, and the other one had a tragic ending where he was crucified on the cross, as was the norm in those times. And then we concluded where Yusuf alayhi salatu was salam, before one of the individuals left whom he knew was going to be granted deliverance from the prison and the jail, he whispers to him and says, look, just make a mention of me when you're by the king. When you have a moment with the king, just tell him that there is a person in the jail languishing, and he's an innocent individual who has been locked up, and his name is Yusuf. But as is human nature, when things are going good for us in life, we forget everyone. And when things are going rough for us, we remember everyone. And this individual, he forgot to mention Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and it resulted in a costly exercise where Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam remained in the jail for an additional 7 years. So now we move on to verse 43, where it's another dream in the tale of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Just to recap, in verse 4, in the first session or second session, we mentioned the dream of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Inni ra'aytu ahada ashara kawkaba wash-shams wal-qamar ra'aytuhum li sajidin. Where he sees 11 stars, where he sees the sun and the moon, they are prostrating to him. And this is one of the reasons that this chapter is named as Ahsan al-Qasas, the best of stories. Why? Because ulama say it commences with a dream and it culminates with the fruition of the dream. So that was the first dream. The second dream was the dream of the two inmates, where one says, Inni arani a'asiru khamra, I see myself squeezing the grapes and forming alcohol and wine. And the other one says, Inni arani ahmilu fawqa ra'si khubza, I see myself that I have got bread on top of my head. And ta'kulu tayru min, birds are coming and they're pecking away and eating away at this bread. And then we mentioned that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he gave the ta'wil and he gave the interpretation of the dream. Now it's the third dream. Now again, this is all part of the planning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to facilitate the release of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works in miraculous ways. Allah ta'ala works in amazing ways. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees something for a person, then it's amazing how things just fall into place. So here, it's the king of the time. It's not the Aziz. One is the Aziz who, like if we remember, he purchased Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam from the brothers. He was the Aziz, his wife was Zulaykha, who tried to seduce Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. He was a high minister, he was still a person in high position, but he was not the king. The king of the time, his name was Rayyan ibn al-Walid. And he was the individual whom one of these two individuals who were the inmates of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam tried to poison. So he sees a vision and he sees a dream. And like I mentioned, when Allah Ta'ala decrees something, something good for a person, when Allah Ta'ala decrees a maybe cure for someone, or on the other hand, Allah Ta'ala decrees disgrace or exposure for a person, so positive or negative, then it's amazing how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works and brings that thing to the fore. So here the king of the time, he sees a dream. وَقَالَ الْمَلِكِ The king, he says, إِنِّي أَرَى سَبْعَ بَقَرَاتٍ سِمَانٍ يَأْكُلُهُنَّ سَبْعٌ عِجَافٍ He says, Inni ara, verily I see, sab'a means seven, baqarat is the plural of baqaratun, which means cow, and simanin means fat. So I see seven cows, and in size they were huge, they were big, they were fat. Inni ara sab'a baqarat, I see seven fat cows. Inni ara sab'a baqaratin simanin ya'kuluhunna sab'un ijaf. And these seven fat cows are being devoured and they're being eaten by seven thin and lean cows. وَسَبْعَ سُنْبُلَاتٍ خُضْرٍ وَأُخَرَ يَابِسَاتٍ And I see seven ears of green wet corn and another seven that have dried up. So in other words, he sees that these cows, the fat cows, they are coming out of a dry river. And upon their appearance, these seven lean and seven thin cows, they devour and they eat up these seven fat cows. But ulama mentioned in the tafasir, it makes no difference to the weight of these seven lean and seven thin cows. Now, when the king had seen this dream, it left him anxious, it left him restless, it left him uneasy. Hence, he assembled and he brought together his people and he engaged in a meeting. And he says to them, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمَلَأُ أَفْتُونِي فِي رُؤْيَايَ إِن كُنْتُمْ لِلرُؤْيَا تَعْبُرُونَ That all leaders, there were many people amongst them, there were soothsayers and there were other people from the royal family and others who used to work under the king. So he addresses them by saying, all leaders, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمَلَأُ أَفْتُونِي فِي رُؤْيَايَ If you can, then tell me in regards to my dream, إِن كُنْتُمْ لِلرُؤْيَا تَعْبُرُونَ If you can interpret dreams. So the last portion already suggests that he wasn't too confident that they are skilled in the interpretation of dreams. So he was confused and he needed some help. So he comes to his courtiers and he comes to his people and he says, you know, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمَلَأُ أَفْتُونِي فِي رُؤْيَايَ إِن كُنْتُمْ لِلرُؤْيَا تَعْبُرُونَ. Now it's amazing, you know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to bring a change, then sometimes it's just a dream. Sometimes it's just a vision or something of its sort. So ulama mentioned regarding Fir'aun, that he is told that a child is going to be born and you will lose your empire and you will lose your kingdom. Historians write, at that time Fir'aun, he stood up and he sat down. He stood up and he sat down and he became anxious, he became restless, he became uneasy. The child is not yet born, you haven't yet lost your empire, yet one vision has made him restless and he can't enjoy anything, he can't eat anything properly. And likewise the king here of the time, he sees this dream and he has become anxious, there's anxiety in the royal family. So he assembles and he brings his people together. And obviously it's royal family, so it's given importance. And anything to do with, you know, people in high position, whether it's the government, the Tories, whether it's the royal family, then it's given importance. Even a stroll on the beach is given importance. You know, you've probably seen the news today as well. And even a trip to, what's that place called, Barnard Castle, is given importance, okay? Because you're a person in high position. This is how the world works. So he assembles his people and he asks them and he poses this question to them that, oh my people, tell me regarding my dream. So in one voice they say, قَالُوا أَضْغَاثُ أَحْلَامُ. أَضْغَاث is the plural of the word دِغْثٌ. And دِغْثٌ literally refers to a bundle of chaff or husk which has been separated from the grain. So they're trying to say it's all mixed up and it's all muddled thoughts. It's all confused thoughts. It's mishmash. There's not much to it. So initially they tried to comfort the king, saying, you know what, it's average, it's nothing much. But then they confess, وَمَا نَحْنُ بِتَأْوِيلِ الْأَحْلَامِ بِعَالِمِينَ, that we aren't too well versed in the interpretation of dreams. So initially they tried to trivialize it, but then they realized, you know what, وَمَا نَحْنُ بِتَأْوِيلِ الْأَحْلَامِ بِعَالِمِينَ, we aren't too well versed in the interpretation of dreams. And this sounds a word of caution for any person. If you can't interpret dreams, don't make your own interpretation. You know, at the least, you just excuse yourself that I can't interpret the dream. So he brings his people together and they hide their ignorance by saying that, you know what, it's all muddled thoughts and confused thoughts. Now, you know, just something to ponder over, how the system of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works. Like I mentioned regarding Fir'aun, and something that comes to mind right now, Fir'aun, he plotted the killing of so many individuals, of so many children, because he feared the collapse of his empire. But the system of Allah Ta'ala was that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was going to be nurtured by Fir'aun and grow up in the house and the palace of Fir'aun. See how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala impresses upon man his ultimate power, might and dominion. So here the king of the time, after he has gathered them and they said, قَالُوا أَضْغَاثُ أَحْلَامُ وَمَا نَحْنُ بِتَأْوِيلِ الْأَحْلَامِ بِعَالِمِينَ, the historians, they write that the king then asked them that, do you know of people who can interpret dreams? So many people were called from far and wide to come and interpret the dream of the king. Remember, he was the king of the time. People were going to give it importance. And there was desperation. So people were brought from far and wide to try and interpret the dream of the king, where he's seen these fat cows being devoured by these seven lean cows. And he's seen seven ears of corn, and he's seen seven others which have dried up. So when these people came, and some of them may have been well versed in the interpretation of dreams, they were left confused, they were left baffled. They could not come to any kind of conclusion regarding the dream of the king. Now amongst these people of the king, one was also the former inmate of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, who was acquitted of any charge and who was reinstated as the wine bearer of the king. So when the topic of dreams came up, he had a flash. And it evoked those memories. You know, sometimes, you know, just one word is enough to bring back so many memories. Okay, so when the topic of dreams came up, you know, it evoked those memories. He had a flash and he's thinking, hey, that's that person, Yusuf. I was meant to make mention of him so many years ago. And then the next verse he mentions, وَقَالَ الَّذِي نَجَى مِنْهُمَا وَادَّكَرَ بَعْدَ أُمَّةٍ أَنَا أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِتَأْوِيلِهِ فَأَرْسِلُونَ. وَقَالَ الَّذِي نَجَى مِنْهُمَا, the one who was granted deliverance, the one who was saved from the two individuals, he said, that after, you know, after a long period of after a long period, after 7 years, he recalled and he remembered. أَنَا أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِتَأْوِيلِهِ فَأَرْسِلُونَ He says to the king, you know, king, I will inform you of the interpretation of the dream. He didn't say, I will interpret the dream. And this is the eloquence of the Quran. Allah Ta'ala uses the word أُنَبِّئُكُمْ. أُنَبِّئُكُمْ means, I don't have the dream, but I will find out the dream and tell you the interpretation of the dream. أَنَا أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِتَأْوِيلِهِ فَأَرْسِلُونَ Hence, he says to them, فَأَرْسِلُونَ Send me to the jail and send me to the prison. It was desperation and they were going to send him. Now ulama say that the prison was in the same city where the king resided. And some ulama say that it was very far from the city where the king resided. Allah Ta'ala knows best. Allama Alusi Baghdadi Rahimullah Ta'ala mentions that some people today, they indicate towards a certain prison which is around 8 miles from the river Nile. Allah Ta'ala knows best where this prison and where this jail is. So the Quran now doesn't go into the minor details, you know, that he maybe had a conversation with the king that, you know what, I was meant to tell him about you. But no, it doesn't go into all those details. It goes straight to the, directly to the point of Hidayah. So the next verse, Yusufu ayyuha siddiq. Now just pause for a moment. Can you imagine the profound impact that the character of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam had upon this inmate? That he had the courage to go back after this many years and approach Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, which speaks volumes of how accessible and tolerant and forbearant the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam were. If it was anyone else, if it was me, and someone says, you know, you need to go back and talk to someone, I'd be like, no chance I'm going, no chance. And I forgot to mention him. What's he going to say to me? He'll probably give me a few punches first and then, you know, no chance. No, I'll give you his number, you can go and speak to him. But look, this inmate, he was confident, he knew of the character of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and he goes back. And when he goes to him, he approaches him and he says, Yusuf ayyuha siddiq, Yusuf the truthful one. Now he does not mention his lapse in forgetting to mention Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And look at the amazing character of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, that he does not even reproach him. He goes straight to the ta'wil and he goes straight to the interpretation of the dream. This is just amazing. So he addresses him saying, Yusuf ayyuha siddiq, Yusuf the truthful one. Now in Arabic there are two words. They both come from the same root words, sad, dal and qaf, sadaqa. So one is sadiq and one is siddiq. So a sadiq is a person who is truthful in his word. Okay? And this is what will come in use to a person on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allah Ta'ala says, Yawm yanfa'u as-sadiqina sidquhum, on the day of judgment, that for the truthful people, their honesty will come in use to them. Allah Ta'ala says in one verse, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu taqullah wa kunu ma'as sadiqeen. O people of Iman, fear Allah Ta'ala and stay with the sadiqeen, stay with those who are truthful. And then you've got siddiq. Siddiq is a higher stage than a sadiq. It's a person who is absorbed in seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's overcome by his truthfulness to the extent that his sayings, his actions and his intentions are all according to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From this ummah, there was Siddiq Akbar. You know, after the stage of Nubuwwah, the greatest status a person can have is of a Siddiq. And from this ummah, we had Siddiq Akbar. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, he was known as a Siddiq. He was the first one to believe in the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was his preaching that converted the likes of Sayyidina Uthman radiyallahu anhu, Talha radiyallahu anhu, Abdurrahman ibn Auf radiyallahu anhu, Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu. And even when the hijrah took place, he was the first one to confirm it, you know, without any hesitation. Hence he was known as Siddiq Akbar. So he approaches him and he says, Yusuf ayyuha siddiq, Yusuf the truthful one, because Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was a manifestation and he was an embodiment of truthfulness. Yusuf ayyuha siddiq, aftina fi sab'i baqaratin simanin ya'kuluhunna sab'un ijafun wa sab'i sumbulatin khudrin wa ukhara yabisat. So he asks him and he tells him that tell me regarding the dream. Aftina fi sab'i baqarat, that tell us regarding the dream where there is 7 fat cows who are being devoured by 7 lean and thin cows, and there are 7 ears of wet corn, and there are 7 others which are dry, and those have withered up. And he says, لَعَلِّي أَرْجِعُ إِلَى النَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ, so that I can take it back to the people, and I can, لَعَلِّي أَرْجِعُ إِلَى النَّاسِ, so that I may go back to the people, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ, so that they may come to know. They may come to know of what? Number one, they may come to know of the interpretation of the dream. Maybe it's mentioning the destiny of Egypt. And number two, so that they can come to know of the fadl and the kamal and the excellences of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. So this concludes here where this inmate, the former inmate of Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam is still in the jail after 7 years. Now Allah Ta'ala causes the king of the time to see this vision. And you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like I mentioned, and I'll end on this, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works in amazing and miraculous ways, and how Allah ta'ala makes amazing interventions for a person. You know, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is in the jail, but somewhere else Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is causing the king to see this vision and to have this dream, which is going to be the means of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam later on being released. You know, in Surah Baqarah, there was that murder that took place in Banu Israel, where they found a corpse, they found a body which was lying there. There are many narrations regarding the motive of the murder, and people were confused that, you know, who's the murderer. Hence they come to the Prophet of the time, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, that ask Allah Ta'ala to identify the murderer to us. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam speaks to Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala tells him that slaughter a cow, take a piece of flesh from the dead cow, strike it on the dead man. He will wake up, he will say, Qatalani fulan, such and such a person has killed me. And then he will die a natural death. And Allah Ta'ala mentions this, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تَذْبَحُوا بَقَرًا. Allah Ta'ala commands you that you sacrifice a cow. And this is one of the reasons, this is the reason it's called Surah Baqarah. It's called Tasmiyatul Kul bi Ismil Juz, where regarding one event that takes place or regarding one verse, Allah Ta'ala names the whole surat. You know, so here is Surah Baqarah. Like you have, obviously Surah Yusuf is regarding Surah Yusuf, the whole chapter. But you've got other places and other surahs in the Quran, like you've got Suratul Nahl, which is regarding the bee, Suratul Naml, which is regarding the ant. There's only one or two verses regarding the ant. Likewise, you've got Suratul Ankabut, there's only a verse regarding the spider. So this is Tasmiyatul Kul bi Ismil Juz. So they say to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, what's the relevance? You know, we want to find out the murderer and you're telling us to slaughter a cow. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam says, do what you need to do. Anyways, Allah Ta'ala made it easy for them. All they had to do was slaughter a cow, but they made it difficult for themselves. They say, Ud'u lana rabbaka yubayyin lana ma hi. Ask Allah Ta'ala to, you know, give us more information. So then Allah Ta'ala says, La farid wa la bikr awanun bayna thalik. Not too old, not too young, it needs to be middle age. Fafa'alu ma tu'maru. Now do what you need to do. But then they still wanted to ask so many questions. What color does it need to be? Baqaratun safra. It needs to be yellow. Faqi'ul lawnuha. It needs to be bright yellow. But the surrun nadhir, it needs to be easy on the eyes. It needs to be like a golden color. They say, give us more information. There's so many different ones. Innal baqara tashabaha alayna. Wa inna insha'Allahu lamu. Where do you find? You don't find yellow cows nowadays, do you? No. So yeah. Innal baqara tashabaha alayna. Wa inna insha'Allahu lamu tadoon. So then they wanted more information. He said it shouldn't be used for tillage, for farming purposes. Musallamatul la shiyata fiha. Needs to be blemishless. It can't have any scar on it. Then musallamatul la shiyata fiha. Qalu al-ana ji'ta bil-haq fadhabahuha wa ma kadu yaf'alun. They say, ah, now Musa, you make sense. Fadhabahuha wa ma kadu yaf'alun. A loose translation, they reluctantly, you know, slaughtered the cow. Now, I'm going to tie it up with my point. So now this is taking place somewhere in Banu Israel. And this is a lesson for us that we may be going through some crisis in our life and you think there is no way out, there is no opening, but you don't know where somewhere else in the world or somewhere else Allah Ta'ala is making divine planning for you, where those effects will ripple down and they will come to you and Allah Ta'ala will create an opening for you somewhere. So they had to go out and search for this cow. And it wasn't easy. They didn't have Gumtree and Spock and eBay, where they can filter the results and look for a cow. They had to literally go out there and they'll find a cow which is maybe middle-aged, but then it's not yellow. And then they'll find the cow which is middle-aged and yellow, but it's not easy on the eyes. And they'll find the cow which is middle-aged, easy on the eyes, but it's got a scar on it. So it was really, really difficult. They had to get out there, search and search and search, until they came to a place where there was an individual, a young man who was living hand-to-mouth. And his only source of income was this very cow that they were looking for. So they come to him and say, we need your cow. And he's like, you what? He says, no, we need your cow. He says, no chance of having my cow. This is my only, you know, income. So they say, no, put a price on it. So he says, if you want my cow, then you have to give me gold equivalent to the weight of this cow. And this is that when a person is desperate, they'll do anything. You know, Allah Ta'ala saves us, but when a person has a medical condition and they are told that there's only two or three doctors in the world who can cure this illness, and these are the consultation fees and this and that, a person will travel and a person will pay what they need to do because it's desperation. So they bring, you know, chunks and chunks of gold to this young individual. And this individual who was, you know, living in abject poverty, he becomes a millionaire overnight. And ulama mentioned regarding it that why? Because he was very kind to his mother and very dutiful to his mother. But this individual, he was just living on his own and with his mother, and this was his only cow. But somewhere else in the world, Allah Ta'ala profiles a cow to the exact cow that he has. And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala takes him from poverty and makes him a millionaire overnight. And here, Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, he is making dua to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. The inmate forgets to mention Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, but Allah Ta'ala then causes the king of the time to see a dream, which will result in Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam being released from the prison and being released from the jail. Let's see what interpretation first he gives to the dream of the king, and let's see what the destiny of Egypt is. May Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala first of all give me and all of us the tawfiq to amal. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.